Good evening and welcome to The Checkpoint right here on Urban TV. My name is Nicholas Wasanja. Now, Uganda has had a successful record of poverty reduction since 1986. Poverty has steadily declined from 56% in 1992 to it had reached about 24% by 2012. However, the Uganda Development Report of 2012 ranks the country as 161st out of 182 countries that it assessed in human development, making it one of the poorest countries in the world. The level of vulnerability has only been exacerbated by the COVID-19 crisis, as you may be aware. With access to social services remaining a challenge, our guest tonight is the Action Aid Director, Business Development, Henry Nixon Ogwal. Welcome to the show.
My pleasure.
Going by your name, I would imagine that you are a Christian. Today being a Martyrs' Day, how have you celebrated it, or what has happened for you today to mark the Martyrs' Day?
What is most important at this time is for families to stay together and reflect onto the Christian values that they have for giving to the poor, those who are much poorer than them, sharing the little that they have, to renew our faith, but also to know that this country, the founding fathers really dedicated it to God. That's why our motto is for God and our country. And our national anthem is actually a prayer. So it's a very important day in most families in Uganda, because we also know that even Muslims were also martyred. So it is not just Christian matters. It's actually religious matters for Uganda.
It's a religious matter.
Yes.
Nixon, going to our discussion today, this elephant in the room called social security. What is it exactly? I'm asking this because tomorrow is the State of the Nation address. It's going to be at State House in Entebbe, and members of parliament are expected there. But our feeling is we need to reflect more on what social security means for Ugandans, and what is it exactly?
Well, it is very important for people to understand social security from a very broad and yet basic level. Because in Uganda, unfortunately, people think social security is about National Social Security Fund.
National Social Security Fund.
Yes. It's bigger than that. Social security are those private or government or public actions that addresses risks and vulnerabilities that individuals may find themselves in such a way that they will fail to cope with life. They may actually even die just because of that.
When so you say this, cope with life, what's at what stage?
It's at all stages, because it affects children, old people, and all that. So this social security is therefore in the way of understanding things to target to see that people get out of poverty. It addresses issues of poverty. Secondly, it looks at issues of vulnerabilities. Because in Uganda, for instance, now, while we have worked so hard on issues of poverty, every three people we have been removing out of poverty, two have been falling back. That means that there is a lot of vulnerability. You can see somebody doing a good business today. 2 years later, you find that that business has collapsed. That's vulnerability in livelihoods. You also look at social protection as addressing issues of equity or inequality. Because, you know, it's a basic right that actually we must have environment that allow all of us to thrive, to grow, to develop, rights to development. So we try to keep measuring whether the outcome of development efforts are being equally spread. That's why we have Gini coefficient for those who have studied economics that try to measure the level of disparity between the rich and those who are not, because that is how the what our national income, it means it goes to fewer people. And in Uganda, it has been growing. So it tries to address the issues of such inequalities. So in all this, then the design is to ensure that we have services by government that will ensure that those gaps are addressed. Interestingly, our constitution is written in such a way that it addresses those things. It requires that we put in place policies, we put in place laws that ensures that nobody will be made to live a life of not of dignity, be they old or their children, and that services of government must address those disparities.
We have a national social security, national social protection policy in place. Mm. So you talk about having these policies and laws in place. Then one that would beg the question, why is it that we still have the largest chunk of our society being vulnerable, yet we have all these laws and policies in place?
Actually, the thing, Uganda is a very interesting country. Mm. When it goes to laws and policies, I think we are the best in Africa, and very good quality when you are a student of policies. Very good indeed. And when you're a lawyer, you find those laws that back up those policies as well are very good. It starts with our constitution, very well drafted. Our problem is about the fact that those policies and laws are not implemented. When they are done, they are implemented haphazardly, not well coordinated. If really we list the laws that are there that support the social protection, the social security and such, there are very many. It includes laws that we all hear about. Child Act, you hear about, talked about Succession Act, you talk about Domestic Violence Act, you know, all these are there to solve those issues. But when you begin to ask how much money we put to support such, you now begin to find that is not there. So when we talk about social protection, people will talk about SAGE, which is about the grants that go to the senior people. But that is just a very small one. So for me, the biggest problem is not investing much public resources. And we have left this to Ugandans fend for themselves. And I would want to remind our viewers that the reason for having states and governments in the world was because those who created stateships, they found out that they could not provide certain services by themselves. They could therefore only do it better when they come together and give off their rights of certain monies to pay tax, so that government would now plan for them and give them the services. So social protection is one of the mandates for the citizens to say, let's have a state to whom we pay tax. And we have leaders who serve us to ensure that when calamity comes, we don't fall below the kind of state of what we have decided for. But right now we are seeing many governments are failing to deliver on that mandate. And it is right now a time when we need to remind, because COVID has actually opened it out and showed that it seems we have not been planning very well. If you look at it, our health services, it is at this time what we are trying to begin to build it, to say if we were to just admit 2,000 people, can we even cope up? We can't. 2,000 people being admitted, we don't have ICUs that can, 2,000, a government in the 21st century. And where we are now appealing to the private citizens and businesses, come and help us, it means that our investment has been quite below. And therefore, going forward, every year, we must be planning for social security and what is buffered for government.
Nixon, we shall get to that. But you highlight something very important. You say that social protection should be, in a way, a system that enables us as lay people to be able to fend for ourselves. But you, by and large, sound elitist, elite. Your viewer out there who is not in the bracket of elites would like to understand, why should they be concerned about social security? Because if, for example, I drive a boda-boda and I'm able to get 10,000 a day. Welcome back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. Today, we are talking about COVID and social security. And our guest tonight is the Director of Business Development at ActionAid, Henry Nixon Ogwal. Henry, when we went for the break, you were trying to point at how the allocation of resources in this country can be restructured to address the social security gap.
Yes. So when you see the kind of issues that is facing this country, but also many other countries, we need very serious restructuring of the budget that has been passed by Parliament. First and foremost, we need to invest a lot of money into the informal sector, because this is where we have the majority of Ugandans. Who are these? These are the young people. These are the young people who have been doing various forms of work. These are the young people who have been riding boda boda. These are the young people that are doing their own different businesses, but they are also women. Women in those informal sector, in the markets, but also employed in agriculture. Basically, when you look at the smallholder farmers, they are the backbone of this economy. They are the people who produce the food we eat, the food we export, what we take to the factories. They are the women. They actually comprise 80 to 85% of the smallholder farmers. These are the people that right now, when you look at them, because of COVID lockdown, they have lost their what? Their jobs. Some of their businesses have been written out. Some of their capital were just about 30,000, biggest probably about 300,000 Uganda shillings. If the lockdown is completely lifted, they will struggle. The economy will then struggle as well. So it is important that money is injected into the informal sector, so much so that, one, it will revive livelihoods of these people, but it will also revive their economic connections, production into this economy. It therefore means that the Ministry of Finance needs to look at this very well and see that this is going to support agricultural production, is going to support services that actually will add back into what will feed the factories, what will also again be taxed later. So this means much money will have to be taken off from the heavy infrastructure, which was meant for good, for a longer future, but for the most immediate, this is urgent. So that is number one, restructuring. The second restructuring that is really required is to see that those who actually will fail to live, we are actually doing it right now by giving food and such. I'm happy that President Museveni says that they have not stopped giving food, because we have also not stopped in the surveillance and tracking where actually corona direction is taking us. So we need to continue to watch those whom life for them will fail. And we ensure that money should be there to support them. More probably quarantine will happen. So we must make money available for those people. And by the way, whom are we going to quarantine? You might actually find these ones you are taking into treatment and into quarantine, they were the breadwinners. So therefore, this is the time when IMF and World Bank would say you can't finance consumption. This is the reason why government exists now more than before. So we should begin to track in all places where life is failing. So there is need for money for that. Thirdly, I think we need to plan for what we call the care economy. You see, there is right now what we call the health services. When you look at health services, most of our people think about doctors, think about nurses as those who are going to inject you, check you. You see, what corona requires more are actually those who are doing the care work, care, even in the hospital. And most of our people in the medical sector are not trainers. Right now, we don't just need medical superintendents. We also now need to create jobs of the care superintendents across the system. So we need to recruit them, we need to pay for them. But this care economy will be within the government system and outside government system, because government alone will not address corona. Corona, just like HIV and AIDS, needs to integrate a lot of community responses with government. That means that government must immediately bring on board the social sector, the NGOs, the civil society, and such. Certain things will be done in communities. All that will require money from here. Let's not talk about donors. It is money from here. The kind of biggest impact we are having is actually psychosocial. It's very heavy. That's why we saw very big increase in gender-based violence and many others. So people are affected. People may have the money, but psychosocially, they are not okay. That in itself will require a lot of national support from these budgets. So then this, once you look at it, you must be seeing that all these things you're doing because you need people to be returned back as economic agents that are active. So reviving companies to hold small and medium-sized enterprises really need to be supported, because those ones employ more. And it's linked to the informal sector. So that back and forward linkage will provide jobs. So that is important. It will be a backbone forward for reviving the economy. So for me, the other side of the budget we need to look at very well are the administrative costs of government that is not related to this revamping of the economy and addressing the social security issues. Should be taken down.
Like which one? Because when you talk, for example, about salaries, are you saying public servants should not be paid?
No, we are actually not saying that. Mm. You see, there's a lot of political jobs that are not going to deliver on what? On COVID. You see, when we were beginning to create like the constituency task force and what, how much money would you be putting into the hands of those MPs and creating a layer of costs that if that money is used on them, you are drawing it away from supporting life on the wire. And actually, if that money is not put for those people who might actually require it, they will die. And that will. So we need to remove away money from non-necessary costs of government, administrative costs.
Nixon, you raise very valid points, but I would tell you, for example, when the budget was being passed in Parliament, there was actually a minority report to that effect, suggesting what you're saying. But one, look at the issue of the resource envelope. We have a resource envelope that is not expanding. Like you raised, that, for example, revenue collection is going to go down. You get it?
Yes.
So one, how best then, and yes, you raise the issue of cutting down the administrative costs, but then there are also other issues that, for example, you're not going to, these are constitutional obligations. You're not going to negate on, for example, allowances of government government officials. So then how best do we address the issue of resource constraints? But also, secondly, the issue of, you say, for example, you should put away money from ambiguous infrastructure development. But then the question would be, what roads are you going to use to take the sick to the hospital?
Well, first, let me start with that one. It's not about taking all the money from infrastructure. The infrastructure we must actually work on are those that are going to be supportive in the immediate and midterm in responding and reviving the economy. In responding to COVID, but also reviving the economy. That is important. We must rebalance that. Now, the issue you have raised begins to get me to talk about the revenue side of the budget. I was actually talking about the delivery side of the budget, the things that matter. In fact, it is things that matter that must drive us to raise the money to fund. It is not the other way around. We must never have national plans and budgets that are driven by money. It must be driven by issues and aspirations. So, in terms of addressing the revenue side, the number of things. But first thing we should avoid is to use austerity measures. Austerity here means reducing the size of the government workers who probably are the ones that are supposed to be responding to this. Critical staff, no, that shouldn't be. In fact, we should even be recruiting probably more to provide technical health and care services. And also remember the other emergencies we have talked about. Technical people are required. So what we are looking at here is that, one, where is our money going to? About 42 to 43% of the money that we are paying on debt servicing. 43 to 42% of it is the percentage that we require to pay for teachers and medical staff in this country. That is how huge that money is. What I immediately, and ActionAid has done a research on this, we are going to launch it soon. Across the world, but also Uganda report is very deep. We need, as African governments, because we now have an emerging deep debt crisis right now.
But the government says it's debt sustainability is not alarming.
No, it is. It is. We understand. We know the measures. We know. So the thing is that we don't need to take any other bigger. What we need right now is as governments of Africa to join together and have one voice. One voice on what? Listen, please. Is that, given the situation as of now, they should negotiate for a suspension of payment, repayment on those what? On those debts at this period. That means that the money that remains available to us will be much more. So that's number one.
But the World Bank group did that.
That is not all. Those are not all the debts you're talking about. You see, when you're talking about World Bank Group, we are talking about all the debts. So wait first, please. So that is number one. And once that is done, that is money getting. But it should not just be done for 2020, 2021. It should also be negotiated, because the impact of corona is not just on this 1 year. It is going to be up to medium term. We need to negotiate that and see a targeted way on getting back to this payment for probably about 5 years. So that's number one. Number two, it is actually about tax. Our tax to GDP ratio is just 13%, much below the sub-Saharan average of 17. But do you know why that is so?
Why?
It is because we give tax holidays to international companies that come here and we never get back. It is because we allow tax avoidance and tax evasion by these companies and ultra-rich people in this country. So we must suspend those tax holidays for them, and also tighten off those evasions by the ultra-rich. These ultra-rich are as rich as those international companies here. That will immediately release more money for financing what we are talking about. We are working with the Uganda Revenue Authority, and we can still speak more about this. The next, because we are talking about how to raise this money, is to also ensure that we widen the tax base. There are many who are not paying tax. In fact, tax in Uganda is regressive. What this means is that the less a person earns in this country, the bigger the proportion of their earning they pay.
Nixon, I want you to join that with the level of social inequality in Uganda.
Exactly. Yes. So I will get that now. Well, so now when you see, we want to see that the more people earn more, the more they are wealthy, the more they should pay a bigger proportion of that wealth. And if we just start with this year, you will see that we will move almost near to that 17%. In the next 3 years, if you just did that, you would see our tax to GDP ratio. 3 to 4 years, you can move near to 20%. That will mean that the money we have in this economy is enough. This going to always keep on borrowing is not the rightful way, but it is to see that the tax is progressive, not regressive. And it will also to attract more of those who are not yet paying. Right now, the mistake we are doing is that the few that are listed as taxpayers, we are only ending with them, and therefore we are really burdening those few. The other, which will be important, is to ensure that as much as possible, those informal sector we were talking about, when you make them more vibrant, those are more new taxpayers. So now, what I would want to link quickly is that the reason why we are seeing the economy that has been growing, yet also growing inequality, and also growing absolute number of people living below poverty, is because of that. The ultra-rich are not paying taxes. They are not giving back to government. Then government cannot meet the services. And that's the reason why we actually want to see that change. Secondly, we also would want to see that...